ever man poly-enamored of the divine beauty, one in whom all the powers of Eros are trained on a consummate end. This is a Christian instinct with a culture of Hellenic idea, who uses a more or less platonic discourse in an attempt to obey highest Christian intuitions. He uses a famous phrase from that great hymn to Spouse of Love, the Song of Songs, which suggests that he is not unfamiliar with the exposition of that book by the great Alexandrian Origen. It is clear then that any attempt to infer from the overwhelmingly moral thrust of Basil's many exhortations to the faithful that he was somehow a mere moralist or rigorist or only an ascetic is to mistake him radically. Without a doubt, a depth of theocentric intensity, a vibrant and dynamic spiritual tonos, is the mainspring of all Basil's approach to the life in Christ. From his own testimony, then, we have Gregory's reading of him abundantly. Tonos. We now ask whether Basil has in him anything of the mystical theologian. Can we find in his writings an ordered account of the further and ultimate reaches of the life of Christ? Can we find in him a theology of the ultimately holy life? To begin with, a burning Godward desire runs through all of Basil's discourse. In Longer Rules 8, section 2, he speaks of a certain tonos, quote, the tension yoked with desire, tonos, of those who follow the Lord. In Shorter Rules 34, also in Latin, one overcomes the passion of cultivating human favour, quote, by an undistracted concern for being well-pleasing to God, and by a burning desire, diapiloi epidemia, for the blessings promised by the Lord. And in SR, the Short of Rule 197, he speaks of, quote, an undistracted and intense desire to be well-pleasing to God that strives wholeheartedly not to fall from the right path. In Basil's teaching, then, this tonos, derived from the verb tenor, to stretch or to pull tight, is the dynamic component of a genuine striving to please the Lord, a tension holding present realities to the goal not yet realized. The same verbal form appears in a compound form in Philippians, chapter 3, verses 13 to 14. But one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward, as epictinomios, to what lies ahead, I press on towards the goal of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Basil cites or alludes to this passage and the Pauline form of this verb throughout his works, many of them quite early in his writing career. This is in a footnote. For example, he uses epectenon in a Shorter Rule 2:11, which is quite brief enough to quote in full. Question. So you'll have some monk, he's come along, and he's addressing this ascetic community, usually, often in a nighttime vigil, and one of those present asks him a question. What is the measure, or what is the extent of love for God? And his answer is, to be ever stretching the soul, to ei ton psikin epitinese, pardon the Greek, to be ever stretching the soul beyond its strength towards the will of God, having his glory as its goal and desire. So then, already in Basil, epeptasis denotes an unceasing forward dynamic of the life in Christ. For the most part, however, he considers that perfection will only be reached in the life to come. And let us not forget that to be perfected, teleotine, is a key concept in Basil's teaching, and that it means that process of growth by which the end, the telos, is finally arrived at. We can easily defuse its negative connotations of perfectionism in English by thinking in terms of maturity, completion, or in another of Basil's favourite expressions, of bearing fit and worthy fruit. All of this is involved in his sense of tonos, this stretching out.